Good morning and welcome to the second meeting in 2015 of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone in the room to switch off mobile phones. Not necessary because they sometimes interfere with the sound systems. But you will note that some of committee members, indeed clerks, are using tablets and that's instead of the hard copies of our papers. I have apologies this morning from Richard Lyle, and I welcome back Graeme Day as the SNP substitute. Welcome, Graeme. I have also apologies from Richard Simpson, who unavoidably cannot be here this morning. Patrick Harvey, welcome, Patrick, who joins us for agenda item number 3. The first item on the agenda today is a decision on taking items in private. And I invite the committee to agree to take item 5 in private today. Item 5 is consideration of our work programme, which we would normally take in private. Is the committee agreed? Thank you for that. Agenda item number 2 is subordinate legislation, and we have one negative instrument before us today, Sports Ground and Sporting Events, Designation Scotland Amendment Order 2014, SSI 2014/374. There has been no motion to annul delegated powers and law reform committee has not made any comments on the instrument. I invite comments, if any, from committee members. I don't see any committee members wishing to make any comment. Is the committee therefore agreed to make no recommendations? I thank you for that. We now move to agenda item number 3, which is to continue our stage 1 scrutiny of the assisted suicide bill. This morning we have one round table on ethical issues, and as usual with round table, we invite the witnesses and committee members to introduce themselves. I should first of all, to my right here is Dr. Mary Neal, the committee's advisor on this bill.
Bob. Bob Doris, MSP, and I'm deputy convener of the committee.
I'm Robert Preston, and I'm director of the think tank Living and Dying Well.
Mike McKenzie, MSP for the Highlands and Islands Region.
David Jones, Director of the Anscombe Bioethics Centre.
And good morning, Dennis Robertson, SNP Member for Aberdeenshire West.
My name is Calum MacKellar, and I'm the Director of Research of the Scottish Council on Human Bioethics.
Colin Keir, MSP for Edinburgh Western.
Stephen Smith, I am a lecturer in law at the University of Birmingham.
Nanette Milne, MSP for North East Scotland.
Good morning, Graeme Day, MSP for Angus South.
Good morning, I'm Graeme Laurie from Edinburgh Law School.
Rhoda Grant, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Patrick Harvey, MSP for Glasgow, member in charge of the bill.
Thank you. And Duncan McNeill, MSP for Gaelic and Inverclyde and convener of the Health and Sport Committee. I should point out that Professor Sheila McLean was unable to be here this morning, but I think we're hopeful that she will participate at some future stage. Bob, could you kick us off, please, with some general questions, and then we hopefully can encourage the participation of the panellists.
Convener, I am going to keep it deliberately general. I may come back in later with some specific questions about the bill. One of the themes running through our briefings in preparation for today's evidence was how we determine autonomy or independence of the individual within society and the choices they make, and the balance between those individual freedoms and choices and the role of the state, and the role of the state to protect, and whether any individual can be truly autonomous and free from, say, pressures from family, financial pressures, in terms of treatment choices, autonomy to make a full choice based on treatment options available, the level of palliative care. And it's where the individual sits within this bill and exercising what would be their rights to autonomy, or whether there's the reasonable interference or intervention or protection of the state towards that individual. So there's constraints upon autonomy and freedoms, and that, in terms of ethical issues, that does seem to be central to it. And hopefully that some thoughts on that initially, before we start to look at the details and the framework of the bill, would be helpful. And I've deliberately not used the word moral during any of that, but I do also appreciate that moral considerations will be a factor for many as well.
If any of our panellists wish to assist us in kicking this off, Professor Laurie, thank you.
Thank you very much for the question. I think that's absolutely crucial here to ask the question, what does it mean to take an autonomy approach to assisted dying? And particularly if you look at the existing legal and ethical framework within Scotland and the wider European context, it's very much centred on the respect agenda, the notion that individuals are autonomous, have the right to self-determine for themselves. And even in the context of the European Court of Human Rights, for example, back in 2002, in the case of Diane Pretty, they recognised that decisions about when and how to die actually do engage your human rights. And the onus is therefore on the state to show why it has to interfere with that, and it has to be able to demonstrate that it's necessary and proportionate in order to do so. In the case of Pretty, for example, they're able to make an argument, the UK government was, that it was necessary and proportionate to protect vulnerable persons. But the important issue, I think, for Scotland is that the onus is on the Scottish state in order to justify its current position. We do not have, for example, the Suicide Act 1961. The legal position with respect to assisted dying is not clear. I think Scotland is going to have to take a decision one way or the other as to how it actually approaches assisted dying with respect to these sorts of decisions. If Scotland were to move forward with respect to a bill like this, the protections of the autonomous nature of the decision must be absolutely crucial. The safeguards that they have in place here, the three-step approach is helpful. Arguably, however, it might be too onerous. There's a question about whether or not the first stage, this idea of having to make a declaration and then two subsequent requests, is actually too much to ask of an individual. The fact that there are medical colleagues involved in assessing capacity is important, but I think we'd also want to make sure that the capacity definition was the same as we find in other legislation in Scotland, so we're not dealing with two different systems of assessing autonomy. And finally, I would say, with respect to this idea of whether or not somebody was subject to coercion, I would like to see in a bill like this, if it were to go forward, some provision that made it clear that if somebody were subject to undue coercion from family or somebody else with a financial interest, that would actually be subject of a criminal prosecution in due course. That's not something that's currently a feature of the bill.
Mr. Preston.
Yes, no one can be truly autonomous in a society unless we're living on a desert island. The autonomy of the individual has to be balanced against the rights of the majority, against the rights of other people, not necessarily the majority. This brings the question down very much to a question of safeguards. If one were to license certain people in certain circumstances to assist the suicide of other people have to be protected, and that brings the debate at once onto the question of safeguards. The bill itself is quite conspicuously lacking in any serious safeguards. It's very long on bureaucracy, but quite short on actual safeguards itself. For example, there's a lot of form filling that's needed, a lot of witnessing and form filling, and two doctors have to be of an opinion, to the best of their knowledge, that certain conditions apply. But there are no processes prescribed which those doctors have to go through to establish as objectively as they can whether those robust safeguards can be put in place. I mean, the bill is full of aspirations on this, but it doesn't actually prescribe any processes to ensure that the safeguards are met.
Professor Jones.
Yeah, on the autonomy question, I think it's important in thinking about assisted suicide that it's the assisting. So it's not actually...
That's what we're dealing with. We're not dealing with suicide. It's not a discussion of the legality of suicide. It's a discussion of the legality of assisting suicide. So it's not simply about the autonomy of an individual. It's about the responsibilities of someone who is not that individual with respect to that individual and their decision-making process. So we're talking about if somebody comes to you with a request, a suicidal request, how do you respond to that? And what are the implications about how you respond to people more generally? So it's already outside the individual. We've already moved from the individual to thinking in general, if I respond to this person in this way and to another person in another way, why have I responded differently? And what are the implications for how I respond to society generally? Because it's about the assisting person. That's what the bill is about. The bill is about legalising something that I could do as an assisting person. And so if you're talking about autonomy, it's actually the autonomy of the assister that's in question here, and whether people should have the right to assist somebody else to kill themselves. That's actually what we're dealing with. And the right to assist somebody else to kill yourself is already something which is relational. So the move to the relational isn't something which is artificial. The move to the relational is already there. And the question to ask, I think, is what are the decision-making processes that people go through in terms of assessing that in these circumstances it is unreasonable for someone to want to kill themselves, and we should have a suicide prevention strategy and we should be choosing life and that kind of thing. And in these set of circumstances, it's reasonable for someone to want to be ending their life, and therefore assistance would take a different form. Because that's not what they're doing, that's what I'm doing as the assister. And that has implications for what society is doing in terms of the values it puts on different kind of people. So already we've gone beyond autonomy.
Dr. MacKellar and then Dr. Smith.
In medical ethics and in medical law, we spend a lot of our time trying to defend the autonomy of patients. We do this in biomedical research, in any surgery and so on. We're trying to make sure the person knows what is happening and can make the decisions for themselves. However, there are some very rare cases where autonomy cannot go first. For example, a person could never sell themselves into slavery, even in Scotland. And I believe that this is one of the cases, assisted suicide, where autonomy has to go second to the whole concept of inherent human dignity. Why can't a person sell themselves into slavery? Because of inherent human dignity. Now, Mike, when I gave submission to this committee, I talked an awful lot about inherent human dignity, and that is the inherent value, worth, and meaning of life. Now, when a society starts to say that certain persons may no longer have this value, worth, and meaning in life, and that we accept it as part of society, that assisted suicide should take place, that the Scottish Parliament should accept that there are certain persons in Scotland who no longer have this meaning, value, and worth, I believe it undermines the whole concept of inherent human dignity. And it's an inherent human dignity that is the very basis of our civilized society and of the Scottish Parliament. So there are some very rare cases when autonomy undermines the whole concept of inherent human dignity, and that's when it becomes dangerous for a civilized society.
Dr. Smith.
I think I want to start by taking us back to the original question. You used the words truly and completely in your initial question. Can somebody be truly autonomous? Can somebody be completely autonomous? And I think that initially means we've got to take a step back and actually look at what autonomy isn't, this sort of atomistic idea that everybody has that I get to choose for myself and nobody else has any say in it. No autonomous decision works that way. You can't make an autonomous decision that way. There are always influences on our life, whether that be people talking to us, friends and family, financial implications. There are always issues that affect whatever it is decision we make. We don't make decisions unfettered from everything around us. So if we're going to talk about an autonomous decision, we need to be clear that an autonomous decision isn't merely an individual acting alone, separate from the rest of society. They don't act in that way. What we mean, I think, generally when we talk about autonomous is this notion of authorship, that our life is our own. I get to decide how my life operates. I get to make the decisions that are important to me and how I see the world and how I see my place in the world. I don't think that that is, in fact, different from the notion of dignity you're presenting. I don't think it's in conflict with it. I certainly don't think it's in conflict with it in this particular case. The notion of inherent human dignity, if there is such a thing, and I'm generally a skeptic about the notion of dignity to begin with, but to the extent that this notion of inherent human dignity, that we all matter because we're all individuals, that's because I get to have some authorship. we don't expect everybody to act lockstep in the same way. That, if we did that, that isn't respecting dignity. It's not respecting autonomy. Those, the two notions of dignity and autonomy are not necessarily in conflict. And I'm not convinced that they're in conflict in this particular case for that reason, that in this idea that we have in some inherent human dignity seems to me based upon this notion that we are the authors of our own life. And if you've ever read a book or seen a movie or watched a play, the ending matters. There are sometimes really good books or really good movies, and you get to the final 10 minutes and the whole thing falls apart. And you go, oh man, that was a bad movie. It's not a bad movie because of anything other than the last 10 minutes. Endings matter. They matter to the story. They matter to the authorship in the way that the rest of the story does. A bad ending is just as bad as a bad beginning. And so if we're talking about autonomy and dignity, we have to, I think, see autonomy in less atomistic terms and more in terms, I think, of this notion of an authorship.
Thanks for that. And I think the panel members are anxious to get back in. Mr. Preston, and I think Dr. MacKellar wishes to come back in.
Thank you. If autonomy is the driving force of the bill, I think one is entitled to ask, why is it restricted to assistance with suicide? What about, for example, the autonomy of people who are not able, even if they're supplied with lethal drugs, for example, to take their own lives? Why are we having this restricted form of autonomy? As a second point, we have to consider the impact of legislation on social attitudes, and social attitudes are very strongly connected with ethics. As a society, we treat people who attempt suicide with understanding and compassion. But as a society, we do not regard suicide as something which is to be encouraged or assisted. I mean, that's what all the suicide watches are about, where people are considered to be at risk of harm. That's what all the attempts to resuscitate attempts at suicides are about. That's what all the suicide prevention strategies that successive governments, both north and south of the border, have introduced. That's what they're about. And finally, we have to look at another aspect of this. I think that the trouble with the focus on autonomy is it tends to present the law as something which is trying to stop you doing what you have a right to do. The purpose of a law which restrains us from assisting other people's suicides is to protect vulnerable people. Now, a law which says that people who have certain medical conditions may be given assistance with suicide may have been framed with the best and most altruistic intentions in mind. I'm sure that's what's behind this bill. But it is, in effect, saying that the protection which the law gives should be different if you have certain medical conditions from those who don't have certain medical conditions. And it is arguable that a law like this could very well send the message, if you are chronically or terminally ill, the law will offer you less protection than if you're not chronically or terminally ill.
Dr. Smith said, and the link between autonomy and inherent human dignity. I believe inherent human dignity cannot be restricted just to autonomy. I mean, I'm a scientist originally, and from a scientific perspective, everybody here is a pile of biological cells. That is all we are. That is all we can prove that we are. That we are more than that. We believe, each one of us, that we are more than that. We believe that we have value and worth. But it's not down to autonomy. It is because we believe in each one of us that we have value and worth, that we actually respect the autonomy of others. Now, in the past history of humankind, there were certain persons that had full autonomy, but which the state refused to give value and worth. So autonomy cannot be the basis of inherent human dignity. It is only because of inherent human dignity that we respect the autonomy of others. And this is actually reflected in the European Convention on Human Rights. Article 2 of the Convention all states about the worth of life, the value of life, and that is why it should be protected and respected. It's only in Article 8 later on that the concept of private life comes in and the concept of autonomy. Now, I understand that for a lot of people, this concept of inherent human dignity is extremely difficult to determine. There is actually no definition of inherent human dignity in the Council of Europe, which is responsible for the European Court of Human Rights. There is no definition of even a human being, either in the Scottish Parliament or in Westminster. But we all agree, and we've got to agree, and we cannot prove this, that we all have this inherent human dignity, which is the basis of the fact that we all have equal rights, an equal value, an equal worth. Autonomy goes up and down with persons. There are some people in Scottish society who have a lot less autonomy than others. There are certain people in Scottish society who have a lot less quality of life than others, but they have equal value, equal worth, and equal meaning in life, and that is based on inherent human dignity.
Thanks. Okay. Any other? Dr. Smith?
Well, I'm not sure I ever said that dignity and autonomy were the same thing. I said that dignity and autonomy were linked in this particular case. I'm happy to accept that dignity, and again, I'm a skeptic about the notion of dignity to begin with, but I am happy to accept whatever it is we mean by dignity, it is a separate thing from whatever it is we mean by autonomy. That's fine. But that doesn't mean in this particular instance they aren't linked. So having something linked, having them be connected, having them be in some sense mutually supportive, which I think they are in this case, in no way indicates they're the same thing. I think to the notion that we are all individuals, we all have individual moral worth, is fine. I am happy to accept that. I think that's because we allow people to make decisions, at least in part. So it's this notion that we are all individuals, and I'm not convinced that being able to take away decisions from people, to say to them, well, in this particular instance, we do not like your decision, so we're not going to allow you to make it, is in fact representative or of this notion that we all have inherent moral worth. People make decisions we don't like all the time. And as a consequence, we have to accept that's the whole reason we have a society, is to allow people to make decisions that we don't agree with.
Dr. McKellar, I will, but I've got another couple of panelists, and you know, thanks for your full participation here. The MSPs could get a morning off here, I think. Professor Laurie, and then Professor Jones, thank you.
It's just to follow up on this discussion about the relationship between autonomy and dignity or not, and just to remind the committee that the previous version of this bill had dignity in the bill. And I was one of the people that actually argued very arguably, strongly against that, because for exactly this confusion, I don't think it's helpful as a legislative device. I think it's actually problematic. And one of the advances that this version of the bill is making, in my view, is it is focusing on a notion of autonomy. It is exploring it, inviting us as a Scottish society to explore it as an aspect of the respect agenda, and it is about the choices that individuals make that are able to make it. So there is another question, if it is about autonomy, about who qualifies. So at the moment, it's focusing on life-shortening and terminal conditions, but what about people who are in excruciating pain but whose life isn't short? That's a very, very good question to ask. But it doesn't mean to say that it has to be a question that has to be addressed in the first iteration of any act that were passed. One thing I would argue very strongly for, and our institute has said this in our submission, there needs to be regular review, arguably a periodic 3-year regular review. And one of the things would be asking exactly that question, but whether or not the notion of autonomy that's being embodied in law is an appropriately inclusive one. But political expediency would indicate that you have to be cautious at this first stage. And I think that's what this represents.
Professor Jordan.
Take the opportunity to agree with things that Dr. Smith and Professor Laurie have said, both in their submissions and here, and make some qualifications, but mainly to agree. One thing, just to start with, Professor Laurie, in the J. Kenyon Mason submission, one of the things I think was argued very well was that the consistency of saying that you will only have this for over 16-year-olds and it won't be available for people under 16, is open to legal challenge in the future. And so if you pass this bill, if this parliament decides to pass this bill, you shouldn't believe that what it says on the bill is what will actually happen come future legal challenges. And that's because of the consistency of the law, and that's because of the logic of the bill. So the logic of the bill is such that if it applies to people who are in a particular category, and if that's based on a right, then you say, well, why do you, if, why is this right excluded from mature minors? And I don't think that's unsustainable. And I also think that's why it is worth looking not just at the bill, but also what are the logical implications of the bill in terms of further down the line. And in respect to mature minors, I'd call people's attention to Belgium, which in 2002 legalized a form of assisted dying, euthanasia, so not exactly this form, but legalized euthanasia in 2002 for over 16-year-olds, and then in 2013 extended the law to minors with no lower limit, and that was precisely because of these kind of arguments. And I noticed also that Margaret MacDonald in her memorandum said she hoped that there would be a chance to revisit after the experience people had had of the legislation, and you said in regard to review that this would need to be reviewed. I think that if you're concerned at all about the principle of some of the sort of underlying principles of this bill, then it is worth thinking not just about what is on the face of the bill, but what are logically connected to the face of the bill and what might be further down the line, because that's actually what would be voted for. What would be voted for are things that follow. And I was going to agree with something I'll just say very quickly because other people want to get in. But I completely agree that it's important to make decisions in life, that the end of life is very important for people, and that people should be involved in the decisions that they make. And that's true also throughout life, and it's true at the end of life. And I also agree with you in your submission that there are connections, and it's useful sometimes to see assisted suicide in relation to other end-of-life decisions. But also with regard to other end-of-life decisions, though we have a right to refuse interventions, we don't have a right to demand interventions, irrespective of what the medical establishment and society and the particular doctor think would be beneficial in this instance. So with regard to other kinds of decisions, we don't have full autonomy. Our autonomy is restricted in terms of what, not only what we're doing, but what people are doing with us and for us and around us. And again, I'll come back to the point, this is not just about, it's not just about my decisions. I have a right to make my decisions. It's about other people's decisions in respect to me. And what's the logic of those?
Dr. MacKellar, did you want back in?
Let's just say a few words. I mean, down in London, the Human Fertilisation and Embryology Authority that regulate everything relating to human embryology, they regularly have horizon scanning sessions, and they define it as a systematic examination of information to identify potential threats, risks, and emerging issues and opportunities. So maybe this is an area where we can have a horizon scanning. If this bill is legalised, what will happen in the future? Now, this bill is based on three things: autonomy, quality of life, and dignity. On the basis of autonomy, if a person, at the moment the bill is restricted to persons who are ending their lives, but on the basis of autonomy, a person who is tired of life should rationally be also able to end their life. And this is something that was already happening in the Netherlands. People who are tired of life on the basis of autonomy are also accessing euthanasia. Not many, but there's a few. On the basis of quality of life, then there are, of course, this bill is restricted to people who believe that their life has no quality and that they are dying. But a lot of people who are unconscious, who've never been conscious, also may have an extremely poor quality of life. In the future, from a rational perspective, the bill should also be extended to them. Yeah. So if we legalize this, what are the consequences from a rational perspective of extending the scope of applications to other situations? That is a question, and that's a session that we should look at.
Yes, Dr. Smith?
I think Belgium and the Netherlands are slightly a red herring. Belgium and the Netherlands have what are out-and-out euthanasia laws, but their laws are based upon a different foundational claim than the one that's being talked about in this particular bill. The Belgium's law is based on the Netherlands law. The Netherlands law changed in about 1984, and that happened on the basis of a notion of unbearable suffering. So the first case in the Netherlands which dealt with this is an instance where somebody helped, I think she was a doctor, but it was her mother she was helping or something. It was the defense to the murder charge was a defense of necessity, that essentially she had two ethical duties. Her first ethical duty was to deal with the unbearable suffering of her patient. The second ethical duty was not to kill her patient. Those two were in conflict in this particular case, and therefore she chose the duty of helping prevent unbearable suffering over the duty not to kill. That was a necessity defense. It's a defense, and in fact, the entire Dutch system is based upon the notion of unbearable suffering. As a consequence, when Belgium basically decided to do similar things, their notion of euthanasia is again based upon this idea of unbearable suffering. As a consequence, this, when we get into these claims about, well, what will happen if it comes into effect, there are going to be different logical implications of that. The logical implication of unbearable suffering is unbearable suffering will happen whether or not you're autonomous or not. That's perfectly understandable. If the notion is based upon autonomy, which is what this legislation or what this bill is, what the Oregon legislation is in Washington, and those are based on a notion of autonomy, those have different implications. So you're saying, well, if somebody's suffering unbearably but unconscious, or suffering unbearably but doesn't have the capacity to tell us, shouldn't they be entitled to the same thing? Well, no, because it's not an autonomous decision. If the decision is based upon some notion of autonomy and you don't have the ability to make an autonomous decision, then it simply doesn't apply in that particular case. We, for example, do not allow people who lack capacity to get married, because even though they may really like the person but lack capacity, it requires an autonomous decision in the same way that this bill does. As a consequence, I think we need to be careful about extracting what the Belgians have done or what the Dutch have done to what might happen here. If you're going to do that, you've got to pay attention to the whole system. And their system is radically different than the one that's being proposed in this particular case.
Preston, and then Professor Jones.
The brief comment. Dr. Smith is right that the laws in the Netherlands and in Belgium are based on, I mean, in the case of Belgium, I think the patient has reached a futile condition. In the case of the Netherlands, there is unbearable suffering. But this bill is also based on the concept of unbearable suffering. If you look at the words, I mean, we're playing with words here if we're not careful. If you look at the words of the declaration at Schedule 2, the applicant says, I have reflected on the consequences for me of the considerations set out in paragraph 6, and that is that I have an illness of the condition set out in paragraph 7. And in the light of having done so, I have concluded that my quality of life is unacceptable. In other words, there is a judgment being made here, not simply about autonomy, but a judgment which is partly on the patient's ability or perceived ability to accept a certain quality of life.
Professor Jones.
Yeah, well, I was going to make the same I actually have the same position, the quotation in front of me, but just to extend it. And not only does the patient have to say that, but the doctor has to say that the patient is being reasonable in saying that. So not only does the patient have to say not just that they're being autonomous, but that they're being autonomous in relation to what? In relation to what? In relation to ending their life. And why? Well, because their life involves some kind of, we might call it quality of life is unacceptable rather than unbearable suffering, but this is playing with words. It's about the quality of life of the person, and that's something which the doctor is being encouraged to make a judgment on the reasonableness of that judgment, and that's that the ability of the doctor to make that judgment means that the doctor could make the same judgment with respect to somebody who had not requested. That is to say, if the doctor can say of this person, yes, I think that your decision, your claim that this quality of life is unacceptable is a reasonable claim. If the doctor can do that, then for someone who is not able to enunciate, the doctor can also make a reasonable decision about whether this is a reasonable quality of life, whether this quality of life is acceptable, because the doctor is being encouraged in this to make judgments in relation to quality of life judgments, the reasonableness of quality of life judgments. Otherwise, anyone without any qualification could say, I would like to have assistance with suicide, and the doctor would just have to say, well, yes, you can have suicide without any qualifications. Why are there any qualifications? There are qualifications because some claims are thought to be more reasonable than others, and some claims about what is unbearable or likely to be unbearable or in the general field of it would be reasonable for someone to say their quality of life is unacceptable are reasonable claims which need to be respected. Whether other kinds of claims are not, they're perhaps expressions of depression or they're other kinds of expressions.
Can we move on slightly just a wee bit in terms of some of the discussion brief that we have, and I think it maybe takes us to that area of ownership and whose life it is, and very strong emotions when people think about the end of life and the difficulties. It's my, I own this body, it's my life, and it's my decision to make. So it's not just autonomy, allowing somebody to permission. People think at that point in their lives, and all they've got left, it's very important that it's recognised, it's their life, they own that. Do we have any comment on that? Graeme, I'll always go to the panel first, but I've got a couple of bids for others to come in to move it on as well. It's my life, my body, I own it, my decision. Robert Preston.
I think I'm repeating a point that's been made already, and that is that if you believe that your life is your own to dispose of as you wish, there's nothing actually stopping you doing that at the moment. What this bill is about is not about legalising suicide. It's about licensing somebody else to involve themselves in bringing about your death. That's a totally different matter.
That's fine. Dr. MacKellar.
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Preston. What this bill is about is not about, unfortunately, people committing suicide, and that does happen. What this is about is the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Society accepting assisted suicide. The Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Society accepting that some lives no longer have any meaning, worth and value, and that is the problem. Now, people do believe, and I agree with them, their life is their own. And the kind of dignity that is mentioned in this bill is also their own. It's the kind of dignity of self-respect, the kind of dignity that says, well, I, the way I see myself is important, and becoming dependent on others is a kind of loss of dignity. That kind of dignity is what we call non-inherent dignity. Now, there's lots of different kinds of non-inherent dignity. A high court judge is given non-inherent dignity. But if this high court judge then has a fight outside a pub, he loses this non-inherent dignity. So non-inherent dignity can come and go. However, the whole concept of inherent dignity, where everybody has inherent value, worth, and meaning, belongs to society. It does not belong to the individual. And once you start to see, as a Scottish Parliament, this kind of inherent human dignity can be lost, where do we then go? So it does not belong to the individual. Inherent human dignity belongs to the whole of society. It makes this whole of society civilized. And I would argue it's the basis of this Scottish Parliament.
Professor Laurie, and then Dr.
In many respects, the current legal position embodies what you said, Chairman, about this idea, it's my body, it's my decision, because we have an absolute right in law to refuse medical care, whether with good reasons, bad reasons, no reasons, or irrational reasons. As long as you're competent, you can refuse. Now, the idea, however, that that's only morally implicates the individual who refuses is a nonsense. I agree with colleagues around the table. Others are morally implicated in that refusal. So all the decisions that we take in life are necessarily involve others. What's being asked here is whether or not the moral decision actually should be extended to those who might be able to assist us in taking decisions where I say I refuse, but I can't necessarily. Obviously, the final act has to be mine in the context of this legislation. But nonetheless, is there a meaningful distinction between some of these acts and omissions? There's a lot of discussion about actually the fact that many of the times that distinction is an irrelevant one. So if we're recognising the fact that people can refuse and can die because it's their choice to do so, the question is whether it's morally consistent not to also reflect situations such as this whereby people can be assisted to die.
Dr. Smith.
I'm a little, and I hear this frequently, but it always slightly confuses me, this notion that if you make a decision that you want to die for whatever reason it is you wish to make that decision, particularly in these contexts, that you're deciding somehow that your life ceases to have value and dignity. That strikes me as not, in fact, what lots of the people who engage in this particular practice are, in fact, saying. What they're saying is, because my life has value and dignity, I want it to end. Because if it continues, it will be worse. And again, to go back to the notions of stories and movies and plays, we don't object to the fact that they don't go on forever. We want, they have to end at some point. The notions that my life at this particular point in time, for whatever reason, is unbearable or I do not wish to continue to have it exist, does not mean that they think it ceases to have value. What it means is the value that they're placing on it is that it's over now. I've reached the end of the journey, it's time to stop. That doesn't strike me as a notion that I've lost value in it. It doesn't strike me in the notion that I've lost whatever it is inherent dignity. I'm also, I think, particularly concerned that this notion that inherent dignity is owned by society and not by the individual. That I'm not quite sure I see a legal or ethical basis in that claim. And I certainly don't, it's not one I would particularly agree with, because society is a collection of individuals, and if society decides these are the things which have inherent dignity, that strikes me as a very dangerous path.
Dr. Preston, then Mr. Preston, and then Dr. MacKellar.
Thank you, Chairman. Something that Dr. Smith said made me think we may perhaps have been going along the wrong tack here. He said that there seems to be an assumption that anyone who, under the terms of a bill such as this, would want to end his or her life somehow believes that his or her life does not have dignity or worth. That is certainly not my point of view. I can't speak for others around the table. I have no doubt at all that anyone, or perhaps most people, who did apply under this bill may well want to go on living but decide that the time has come to die. I'm not questioning the motives. That's not the point. The point about this is that if we are going to give individuals a right to have assistance from someone else to bring about their death, we have to be sure that that will not impact unfavourably on other people. Other people could be brought under pressure or coercion. They could be made to feel that this is the thing that they should be doing. There's been discussion about decisions to refuse treatment, including life-sustaining treatment. When a patient refuses life-sustaining treatment, that is not the same thing as saying, I wish to die. Most patients who refuse life-sustaining treatment are refusing treatment. They don't want the treatment to go on. They accept death as a consequence, as a probable consequence of refusing treatment. But there's a distinction to be made between accepting death and bringing on death. What this bill is proposing, and this is the Rubicon that it's crossing, what the bill is proposing is that some people should be licensed to take action deliberately designed to bring about the deaths of other people. It has never been a defence in law against murder, for example, that the victim consented. The bill is crossing an important Rubicon, therefore, and it's crossing a Rubicon which you can defend with ethical arguments on both sides, but it's crossing a Rubicon which actually flies in the face of social attitudes to suicide.
I see you indicating, Dennis, but I've also got Graeme Day and Patrick Harvey when it's appropriate after the members. And I propose to, after Dr. McKellar's response, to take another question from Graeme Day, if that's okay. Dr. McKellar.
Okay, just to come back to something that Professor Laurie said, I mean, a good example where relational values as seen would be in a hospital where there's two persons who are very, very sick from the same disorder. And one person says, I want to die, my life has no meaning left. And the person, and then accesses assisted suicide in this case. But what kind of message does then that give to the person in the next bed who might be suffering from exactly the same condition or even a worse condition than that? And I struggle to understand what you were saying at the end. I mean, for me, inherent human dignity has a very strong relationship with the meaning of life. Now, if somebody knows that they have worth, value, and meaning in life, why on earth do they want to end their life? There's something contradictory there. And this is something that is also reflected in one of the big campaigns that I believe it was the Scottish Parliament initiated it, and that's the Choose Life campaign in Scotland. This is trying to reduce the very high suicide rate amongst men in Scotland. And what does Scottish society doing? Is it saying, you think your life has no longer any worth. You want to commit suicide. But we as a Scottish Parliament, as a Scottish society, actually disagree with you. We believe that even though you might be suicidal, your life still has meaning. Your life still has worth. And that is why the Scottish Government has sent right around Scotland suicide prevention coordinators to try and reduce this incredibly high rate of suicide. And that is why Mr. Clegg, even just yesterday, was trying to reduce the very high rate of suicide in England. As a society, we believe that every single life, no matter how valuable, no matter how close to death they are, has this equal inherent value, worth, and meaning. And I think as a society, we must believe that. As a Scottish Parliament, we must believe that.
Graeme Day.
Thank you, Convener. I'd pick up on Mr. Preston's point. First of all, surely what the bill seeks to do is bring about the avoidance of unbearable suffering rather than the point you made. I just put that out there. Dr. McKellar's point about looking to horizons, I understand that perfectly. But perhaps there's a danger that we're really missing the point here if we strip this back. What we would be doing, potentially, if we rejected this bill, is saying to people with terminal conditions that they must suffer unendurably, because we say they should. We would, in effect, be imposing that judgment without ever being in the position of understanding where they're coming from. I don't think we can duck that issue, even if it suits us to do that. So the question I'd like to pose is, do we have the right as a society to say that to people?
No, it's to the panel, but if you wish to respond firstly, Mr. Preston.
Thank you. On a technicality, may I just pick up a point you made? You said people suffering from terminal conditions. This bill is not about terminal conditions. This bill is actually about chronic and terminal conditions. If you read the provisions of it, you simply have to have a progressive and life-shortening illness. There are hundreds of thousands of people. There can't be a street in Scotland where there isn't somebody in that category. But, you know, if I may say so, sir, you're turning the argument on its head here. You're saying that if we don't have a law like this, you are compelling people to suffer. Now, I accept that in certain cases, then it may not be possible for modern medicine to find pain relief, other symptom relief. That may be the case in some cases, though it is increasingly not the case as medical science advances. But you cannot therefore say, well, in that case, you are forcing people to stay alive in suffering. We must change the law. The case has to be made for changing the law.
Dr. McKellar, then I have Professor Jones.
The whole concept of suffering for me is a very difficult one. It's, the more you think about suffering, the more mysterious it becomes in a way. It's, suffering is part of what human beings are. Some of the greatest human beings in history have suffered an awful lot. I don't understand suffering. I can't give you an answer to this. What I do know, though, is that, and you'll have a session with, I believe, palliative care consultants later on, is that suffering in hospices, at least, is hardly there. Physical suffering, I'm talking about. Now, there are situations where a person might be very much isolated on some of the islands, or maybe some of the training of the general practitioners may not be appropriate where physical suffering does arise, and I would not deny that. There's a different kind of suffering. The second kind of suffering is psychological suffering. And again, from what I read from the Royal College of Psychiatrists, when depression is diagnosed and this depression is encouraging the person to try and end their lives, that can be treated. Not in every case, but in nearly every case. What we're actually talking about in this bill is existential suffering, the suffering that comes from being afraid of death, being afraid of being lonely. Now, that kind of suffering is not medical. It's just the kind of suffering that we all have faced with the fact that we're all going to die, many other things. But what I do know is that, and I'm going to come back to this concept of inherent human dignity again, it cannot be trumped by suffering. A lot of people suffer. We all suffer. A lot of people suffer a great deal. But they still have their value and their meaning and their worth. And if we put it the other way around, if suffering trumps inherent human dignity, then again, everybody is different. And everybody has a different value, a different worth, and a different meaning. And we cannot live in that kind of society. We are all equal. We must remain equal.
Professor Jones.
Yes. Do you agree with something else that Dr. Smith said in the submission? And that's that it's useful to look at what's happened in other jurisdictions. With the qualification that he added, that we need to look in detail because each jurisdiction is different. But there are basically five, I suppose, Netherlands, Belgium, Luxembourg, Switzerland, and three now states, though two only with evidence in the United States. And with respect to the differences from Scotland and the differences to one another and the differences of legislation, they at least provide evidence. And I think that we will probably look at the evidence differently, but I agree that then we would have a more concrete idea of what we're talking about. I think it is a false dichotomy, whatever law you're talking about, whatever discussion you're having, to say either we do this or we do nothing. So to say people have unbearable suffering, so either we change the law or we leave them in their suffering. Well, whatever the alternatives are, there's more than just two alternatives. I think it is the case that there are unmet needs, and whatever the state of medical science might be, there are certainly unmet needs out there with respect to healthcare in general, with respect to people with chronic conditions, and also with respect to support at the end of life. And certainly more needs to be done. And again, even if, and I would be strongly opposed to it, but even if the law changed, that would still be the case, because it would not be the case that everyone who had a bad death decided that suicide would be a less bad death. And the problem, we will all die. Everybody around this table will die. And the question is, how will we best be supported when we die? And to what extent will this changing this law address that problem? And I think that it won't address that problem for most people. I don't think anybody here thinks that most people are going to access this law. So most people are going to die and need other kind of support. So what I think, if we go back to Belgium, which is one of the countries on my list, one of the good things that they did in 2002, they passed two laws at the same time. One was about assisted suicide, and the other, which was a kind of political agreement, is that they passed a law about palliative care, and they gave a statutory right to palliative care. The result being you had increases year on year, significant increases of funding for palliative care, and they really crept up the table, and they did a lot of good work. And what happened in Belgium was mixed. And some things I strongly oppose happened in Belgium, but some good things happened in Belgium as well. But what I'd say is, don't think that this law is, or this is the only possibility on the table with respect to answering the need for people who are suffering with conditions or thinking about their death. There must be other things to think about, other things to do, and I would say that those things often are a priority. And I think that they are, and we shouldn't be complacent. And sometimes I think that people are opposed to these kind of legislation sound rather complacent, as though hospices have it sorted out and you can have a good death. That isn't the case. For most people, they can't access it. So it's not just about what can be done in the best case, it's how you deliver this across a society. And that's a question which we're going to have to answer whatever is done in this chamber. And that's, I think, the more important question when you're talking about people's suffering for more people.
Professor Laurie, and did you want back in? Yes.
As I think we're agreeing, it's not for any individual, any parliament or any society to prescribe how somebody dies. Many people die in many, many different ways. This is about giving people, a small number of people, a choice to die in a way that they would determine. And one of the examples that we haven't actually mentioned so far this morning is the Oregon example. And I think the Oregon example and their legal framework is actually more akin to what's being proposed in Scotland than Belgium or Netherlands or elsewhere. If you look at recent figures from Oregon, in 2013, for example, fewer than 22 deaths in every 10,000 were as a result of the legislation. That's 0.0022%. So you're talking about a tiny number of people. But nonetheless, it's facilitating the choices of those people and how they would choose to end their life. And they're not scared of death itself. They're scared of a wild death. And if you look at the evidence that they've got, the evidence suggests, as in previous years, that the three most frequent reasons why they chose that particular option for themselves were loss of autonomy, 93%, a decrease in ability to enjoy to have an enjoyable life, 88.7%, and loss of dignity as they saw it, not necessarily as how it was being defined by somebody else objectively, and that was 73%. So this bill is about those type of people and giving those type of people the choice that they would want. It's not about prescribing it for everybody else.
Mr. Preston.
Thank you, Chairman. I wasn't going to talk about Oregon. As Professor Laurie has raised it, I have to, because I'm afraid he's rather adrift here. This bill is not similar to Oregon's law, Oregon's so-called Death with Dignity Act. Oregon's law is limited to people who are terminally ill with a maximum of 6 months to live. It is much more akin to Lord Faulkner's bill south of the border. This bill is for people who are chronically and terminally ill. We're not talking about the sort of catchment area we have in Oregon here. We're talking about a catchment area which is perhaps 10 times as large. There are huge numbers of people who have the sort of illnesses which are prescribed in this bill. We do not know how Oregon's law is working because there is actually no audit system. A doctor is required to report that he's done it, but that's the end of it. Nobody actually examines the cases and says whether they've been carried out in accordance with the law. Now, the point I was going to make, and I'll be fairly brief about this, Dr. MacKellar has raised the question of existential suffering, and I agree that a lot of the suffering that is involved here is existential. It's about wanting control of one's death. It's about wanting to die as I want to die. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with that at all. However, there are cases, I think, where there is physiological suffering as well. Suffering, and here I agree with Mr. Day, that there are cases where even the best palliative care can't actually bring relief of suffering. I would be prepared to go along with such a law if two conditions were fulfilled. First of all, that evidence had been presented to me that the law as it stands was actually proving oppressive. Now, I've not seen any evidence on, and it's one of the questions which those proposing laws of this nature seldom address. The second one is, if it were a bill like this, I would say no. If this bill could be tied down, if it could be very clear, made very clear in the bill, that there are serious safeguards, not just a doctor saying, to the best of my knowledge, or in my opinion, but actually having to go through specific processes to establish that the person met all the criteria, I might be prepared to go along with it. The bill as it stands is simply not fit for purpose.
Professor Jones, yes, of course.
Just to say, we need to look at all the evidence. There's a limited number of countries, but there are differences in many ways between this country and Oregon. Many of them, I'm glad there are differences between this country and the state of Oregon. But don't just look at Oregon, look at Washington, which within 4 years has massively overtaken Oregon already in the numbers. But also, and here I think I agree with Mr. Preston, this law is much wider. And therefore, consideration needs to be given of Switzerland. And now Switzerland is wider still, so it's something in between. But in Switzerland, you're talking 500 deaths a year. So you're not talking about 70 deaths in Oregon. You're talking about 500 deaths a year of Swiss citizens and 200 further deaths for suicide tourists. So you're talking 700 deaths a year. So that, a factor of 10. Now, Switzerland is bigger. Twice the size of Oregon, but it's only twice the size. So it's still that Oregon and Belgium and Switzerland are similar sized countries to Scotland in terms of if you want to look at sizes of population. But Oregon is not. It won't necessarily go as it goes at Oregon, and because of the nature of the legislation, I think a lid needs to be lifted off what's happening in Switzerland, because there actually is not enough data on what's happening in Switzerland. But the numbers are much higher, and the safeguards are much weaker. But I have great misgivings about the supposed safeguards in this bill. So do look at all of the countries where you have assisted dying, and make your own minds up.
MacKellar.
Yeah, I'd agree with what Professor Jones just said. I mean, in countries like Washington, which has a very similar legislation as Oregon, between 2012 and 2013, the increase was 43%, which is huge. Those are the last numbers. In places like Switzerland, the numbers are going up. Again, we don't have the exact numbers, but between 1998 and 2009, numbers of assisted suicide in Switzerland went up by 590%, and that's just for Swiss citizens. For people coming abroad, it's quite different. And we also see similar numbers going up quite quickly in Belgium and in the Netherlands. Now, have they reached a plateau yet? No. We don't know yet where it's going to reach its plateau, but at the moment it's going up quite fast. And we don't know, because as soon as you legalize something, with time, it starts to become normal. It's like, I think there was one submission that was mentioning seatbelts. When seatbelts came and it was done through legislation, at first it was abnormal, but then it becomes normal, and now we don't even think about it. So with time, things become normal. Because things become normal, more and more people access what is being proposed. Also, another thing that makes something become normal are just sheer numbers. The more people access something, it becomes more normal as well. So there's a sort of feedback system that's taking place. So we don't know what's going to eventually happen in Oregon or Washington. We don't know yet. And this is why it's very important to do some horizon scanning and look at Oregon and Washington and maybe Switzerland as experiments. But it's experiments to which we don't yet have the results.
Yeah. I'm going to try and get a couple of members in terms of time. There may be some similar questions and answers, but I'm going to ask Dennis Robertson, and with the committee's permission, I'm going to skip a bit and take part at Harvey, although I still have members of the committee to ask questions. Is that okay? I see people nodding. Dennis.
And thank you very much, Convener. I wonder if we could maybe explore, as we mentioned a few times, the term coercion. And obviously, some people are more susceptible to persuasion. I think we all are sometimes susceptible to persuasion if there's a good argument. But as we mentioned, coercion, and I'm just wondering what the safeguards are, because, Dr. MacKellar, you've mentioned quite often the suffering of the patient. And I'm just wondering sometimes if the patient is looking beyond themselves and looking at the impact maybe of their condition and wanting to take their life because they're seeing the impact on others that are caring for them. And their decision isn't really based maybe on the quality of just their life, but they're looking at beyond that, at the quality and impact that their suffering, to your terms, is having on others. How do we safeguard against that sort of coerced aspect that maybe people can apply on the patients?
Thanks for that, Dennis. There's a whole series of questions in and around that vulnerability and why people would be coerced or pressured to take decisions. Professor Jones, I think, made the first bid, and then Mr. Preston.
I don't think it's just about coercion. It's influence is much broader, and there's a whole question. And if we're anxious about influence, that's because we're in the whole notion of assisting, encouraging, relating to others. So we're not, again, I can make that point. But I think it is. Regrettably, in my experience, it is regrettably common that people think that other people will be better off without them, and that they severely underestimate the grief that people will feel after them, certainly with regard to suicide, ordinary suicides. It is an aspect of suicide that people often think other people will be better off. They sometimes think of others. They don't just think in a selfish way. But it is archetypically devastating to those who are left behind. Not in every case, not equally, but it can have a hugely negative effect on those left behind. Particularly that they weren't able to help the person that the person. So you also have not just somebody would be better off dead, like, but you have this one person thinking wrongly what other people think. So the person who is vulnerable making assumptions about what other people think who care for them, that they're this burden and that kind of thing, when it isn't necessarily the case. I mean, so we shouldn't just think of unscrupulous relatives who don't want the person around and that kind of thing. I think that it's often you have a misperception, and a misperception because of dependence and vulnerability, about a lack of solidarity and a lack of relationship, so that they think that when I'm gone it will be better. But depending on how I go, it might not be better at all. It might actually be much worse. And the ability, I think, sometimes people have to try to let other people care for them, and that's not easy. But it certainly is something that people are. It's an idea people are vulnerable to, and they're very vulnerable to all kinds of suggestions. I don't think there's anything in this bill, for example, which would stop a doctor from suggesting assisted suicide as a reasonable option among your treatment options. I think in your situation, I might consider assisted suicide. There's nothing which would stop this, and if it's a normal end-of-life decision, it wouldn't be coercive to suggest among a range of decisions this. But I think that we have and should have huge misgivings about other people suggesting, even suggesting, because that suggestion is invidious. It's insidious, rather. That's what undermines, because all the time you've got this kind of, what are people thinking about me? Would people be better off without me? And it's a misperception, but it's one which I think people can easily fall into.
Mr. Preston.
I'll be brief, Chairman, thank you. There's a spectrum here. There's the arm-twisting coercion through to the hints which are dropped, the suggestions which may be made, to something called care fatigue, which relatives do suffer. There are an increasing number of people today who are incapacitated, who have to be looked after by their families. Often in those families, they need two people working to pay a heavy mortgage. One member can't work because the person has to be looked after. You can see the situation. Well, I'm going to die in a year, 2 years' time. Why don't I get it over with now? Leave my inheritance. They're struggling financially. They can't be looking after me. So, and I agree with Dr. Jones on this. It's a very wide spectrum. How do you guard against it? A doctor assessing this might be able to detect it if he knew the family, but do we live in that kind of society? My doctor has never been to my house in 12 years. If I applied for assisted suicide, he wouldn't have an earthly as to whether I was being coerced, as to whether I was capable. He wouldn't have a chance. We don't live in the age of the family doctor who knows the family, who knows whether coercion is taking place or not. And we have laws, not because most of us behave decently, but because some of us don't. We should remember that.
Dr. MacKellar.
To come back, I mean, Professor Laurie mentioned the three first reasons why people accessed youth-assisted suicide in Oregon and Washington. Actually, the fourth reason, and this is 61%, and these are the last results from Washington, it's because they are a burden on family, friends, and caregivers. Actually, there's also financial, I mean, one of the reasons, and that's 13%, is financial implications of the treatment. I think in a society, we have learnt that in a modern society that being a burden on others is dishonourable. But I believe that in our society in Scotland, we've got to relearn that to be a burden on others is normal. It's acceptable. It's what society is all about. We had an African physician on our council who was from a Muslim. And he said that when he was went to his first debate on euthanasia and assisted suicide in Scotland, he was horrified. Because for him, people who were disabled, people who were maybe old and so on, were honoured in his village. And we've got, as a society, to relearn that. We all started off our lives being completely dependent on others, and some of us will end our lives being dependent and completely dependent on others. But there is no dishonour. And I've got to learn that as well. I've got to remind myself that I should be proud of maybe being a burden on others, because they want to help me. They're my friends. And a real society is a society where people are friends. So that's all I wanted to say. Thanks.
Professor Laurie and then Dr. Smith.
Thank you. We clearly can't second-guess people's reasons or circumstances, whether there would or would not be undue influence. All that we could hope for in a legislative framework like this is to put in place particularly tight measures in the first round of review. And one of the things that I would like to see in such a bill would be an authority that had a clear position to act, to review the request, to review the reports, and to be able to intervene timiously. And secondly, when you're talking about having the two doctors involved, there's no suggestion that they need to be independent of each other, so make sure that there's some degree of independence, and make sure that in the first period of review, Scotland would be able to build up as robust an evidence base about what was actually going on, and to review that in due course, and then ask what is the evidence actually showing, whether or not there is or not been suggestions of undue influence or not, and then act accordingly. But I would be very concerned if we were speculating about the possibility or the likelihood of that when we really don't know.
We've had some, you know, in terms of the law and homicide and subsequent investigations, and you know, maybe be going to your novels or films, Dr. Smith. But it's not inconceivable that suddenly a surprising inheritance has been found, or there's been and how are those people protected? Are they going to face, you know, a prosecution for homicide or something in the future because somebody's discovered that there's an unusual inheritance that has been associated with that it wasn't, you know, it was a surprise to people. How would situations like that be dealt with after the fact? And what sort of possible criminal proceedings could people, rightly or wrongly, well-motivated or not well-motivated, find themselves in after the fact, an investigation and things?
I wouldn't want to speculate on the criminal situation, but what I would say is that the passing of this bill is not just about one piece of legislation, it's about an entire framework. It's about identifying very clearly what is the authority that would be in charge, what powers would it have, who would it have to work with, including, of course, the Crown Office and others. It would also have to work with the professional bodies, including the doctors and the pharmacists. I think one of the reasons why we see in this legislation, or this proposal for legislation, the notion of facilitators is because we know that there's strong reluctance among many sectors of the medical professions not to be involved. But of course, the bill necessarily and does involve them. But there isn't any recognition of the fact that there needs to be some sort of, you know, conscientious objection. I understand that there's reasons for Westminster and reserved powers. Nonetheless, a framework would need to take account of all of this, including the ability to investigate the sorts of issues that you raise there.
Yeah, Professor Jones.
Just on having bodies that regulate or review or that kind of thing, there is a real problem here, and there's a problem almost on the surface of this bill with the facilitators, which is a kind of who guards the guards question. And I think one of the patterns across different jurisdictions is you find that people who have previously pushed for legislation then wish to get involved in pushing the boundaries of the legislation, sometimes through the being on the regulatory bodies and sometimes by having organisations which have mobile euthanasia facilities or have... Very, very few cases have been for review in Belgium and Netherlands, and certainly in the case of Belgium, that's because the most extraordinary cases, and there have been some extraordinary cases, are by somebody who is also on the review panel. And there is a problem when if you have review bodies, and if I think across England's regulatory structures, some of those regulators. Are quite strict in terms of what they require, and others are very close to the people that they're regulating, and very rarely refuse, and actually try to facilitate in different ways. And I think that so don't just think about structures on paper, you know. But it is, you know, it is a question of who guards the guards, and it's not simply we don't know. We can have some ideas by looking at those other countries. So to repeat the question, have a look at other countries and see what can sometimes happen in terms of also some of these regulatory bodies.
Dr. Smith.
I agree with that, and I agree with looking at other countries. I do think we need, when we look at other countries, it's not just about looking at the limited number of countries in the world which allow some sort of assisted dying. So it's not just about looking at Belgium and the Netherlands and Luxembourg and Oregon and Washington and I think Montana, New Hampshire and Massachusetts, I think, are the other three. It's about looking at how things work in the regulatory state we already have. So it's not, in lots of the discussions about assisted dying, it's sort of taken for a given that we prohibit it, as if that isn't a regulatory state. It isn't a regulatory state created by people. And there isn't, in fact, impacts and evidence and downsides to the regulatory state we already have. So we need to, I think, pay attention. If we're going to look at evidence, and I'm a firm believer, we have to look at what evidence there is. We also have to make sure that that evidence is about how are things working now as well. And that, in and of itself, causes... It can be hard to investigate, and as a consequence, there's very limited evidence out there. But the limited evidence we have doesn't show that the current prohibition is all that great a system either. So there is a study from 2002, and it is decidedly anecdotal and a small sample, and it's also from Australia and therefore of an entirely different jurisdiction. But the incidences that come out of that are particularly troubling on notions of coercion as well. That actually what happens is that if you don't have the full and obvious discussions, then people dismiss doctors or they end up going down routes that nobody ever wants to see anybody go down. Coercion happens under whatever regulatory system. If you're expecting whatever regulatory system the Scottish Parliament's going to come up with, whatever it comes up with, is going to be perfect, I hate to tell you, it's not going to happen. There are always going to be incidences of abuse. There are incidences of abuse in any legislation anywhere in the world. The question becomes, how can we limit those incidences of abuse? How can we make the legislation as good as it possibly can be? So I'd echo everything Professor Laurie said about making sure there's an investigatory body, making sure that investigatory body has particular powers which aren't unfortunately available in Oregon. And we've got to pay attention to things like communication. One of the things that I think I have particular concerns about with this particular bill in relation to coercion is this 14-day period, that you've got 14 days to use the prescription. And that, to me, strikes me as a fairly coercive
incidents. What happens in it, there's evidence from it in Oregon, there's evidence from it from the Australian study I just mentioned, that what lots of people end up doing in these sorts of cases is they want the medication but not to use it. They want the medication to have it and to be able to make a decision every day, essentially to wake up in the morning and say, no, I'm good. I don't need this today. And that is, in fact, a life-affirming measure for them. Now, I don't think that would happen in all cases. I don't think that would happen in majority cases. I don't think it would happen in even a significant minority of cases. But it does happen from the evidence that we have. And therefore, if we're going to talk about things like coercion, and I think it's important to talk about coercion and vulnerability, we have to pay attention to the coercions that exist under the system we've already got.
Mr. Preston, and then I've got something.
I'll be very brief, because I know that you want to bring members in, Chairman. Yes, I completely agree with Dr. Smith that the 14-day period in which you must use lethal drugs is silly. I mean, that should go. But that is a form of coercion, I agree. But if you look at the medical practitioner's statement, which is drafted with the bill, to the best of my knowledge, she is making the request voluntarily and has not been persuaded or influenced by any other person, to the best of my knowledge. Is that really good enough? When coercion is there. I mean, you know, I come back to the point I made earlier. There are no processes in the bill for making sure that it is safe. There are only aims.
Wow. Thank you, Convener. It's extraordinary how, in a session like this, simple questions can give rise to very, very complex and lengthy answers. That was probably inevitable with this session. I wanted just to briefly pick up on a couple of areas where I think there may be misunderstanding I'm sure not a deliberate attempt to misrepresent what's in the bill, but comments which could be misinterpreted as in terms of what's in the bill. For example, there have been various statements about people being licensed to take action that brings about someone else's death. That's very clearly prohibited under the bill. We're talking about assistance to allow someone to take their own action at the end of their life. This notion as well that value, dignity, worth and quality of life are the same thing. They're all important concepts, but they're different concepts. And I think it's important to restate that dignity is not defined in this bill, inherent or non-inherent dignity. They're not defined in this bill. We talk about a judgment that a person makes about the quality of their own life. And it was also, I think, implied at one point that this bill could apply to people who haven't made a judgment about the quality of their own life, including people who are incapable of doing so because of unconsciousness. That's also very clearly not set out in this bill. I'd like to ask two questions, one specifically to Dr. Smith and one more general one. The general question is about the kind of comparisons we might make to other ethical considerations. Because autonomy is not an absolute concept in any of our lives, and because we are all, as Dr. MacKellar said, reliant on one another, we all depend on one another as part of a society every day of our lives, these ethical considerations will become complex, particularly in the provision of care to people at the end of their lives or people with complex needs. But that's not the same as a comparison with suicide in other circumstances. When Debbie Purdy died recently, there can be no doubt that she wanted, over a long time campaigned for, assisted suicide. That wasn't available to her, and the only option she had was to refuse nutrition. She effectively starved herself to death. She said very clearly, I don't want to die, but I am dying. There's a difference between taking control of a process that is happening and suicide in other circumstances. Surely the comparison we might make with other ethical considerations are around the proactive actions that people may take in assisting someone to make a decision, for example, to refuse treatment. Placing a do not resuscitate note. That is an action that someone would take to assist someone else, a patient, in giving effect to their own decision. We heard last week about the comparison with a patient coming off dialysis and the knowledge that they might die within days in that context. There are other circumstances, perhaps rare, where someone might choose to participate in an experimental drug trial in the full knowledge, their doctor as well, in the full knowledge that it's not going to give them any particular benefit, that it may even hasten their death, but it could generate research data. That surely gives rise to a far more complex set of ethical considerations which have a closer bearing on the one that we're talking about today than with suicide in other contexts. And the specific question that I wanted to ask Dr. Smith is about the comment he's made on the 14-day period and whether that could itself be perceived as a form of coercion, or it could have the same effect as a form of coercion. The affirming effect that you described in having access to the drug, having a prescription on hand, having the drug on hand, and knowing that each day you might wake up and think, I can get through today, I don't need it today. Can I ask whether you would be convinced that that's due to the physical presence of drugs in the room or in the house or in the building, or is it due to the knowledge of control, the knowledge that the decision rests with the person and that there are people there willing and able to give assistance for a person to give effect to their own decision? Is it about the physical presence of the drugs, or is it about the knowledge that the decision is there in the hands of the person? The 14-day period was struck by Margot as a balance between the ability to know that the judgment of capacity was recent and therefore still had some relevance, and the other considerations that you've mentioned. Could we not assume that the affirming nature of this comes from having the knowledge that the decision is there in your own hands, rather than that the drugs are there on the bedside cabinet?
To be honest, I have no answer to that question because I don't know. I know what the evidence indicates that this practice appears to happen. Mm-hmm. As I said, it appears to have happened. There's evidence from the Oregon that it's happened. There's evidence from the study in Australia that it's happened. I don't believe that they looked specifically in either instance as to whether or not it was the physical location of the drugs or whether it was merely the idea of access. I think in either case, the 14-day period remains slightly problematic, because you've still got to now make a decision within that 14 days. And if through my, even if it's merely the notion of having access to the medication, so I know I can call somebody and get the pills if I need them, as opposed to having the pills right there, that still means I've only got to make that decision within a limited period of time, and I can't go, actually, for the first 14 days, I'm okay. Now on day 15, yeah, it turns out now this is the line too far, whatever that line is. So I don't know the direct answer to your question. I think my concerns about the 14-day period would probably exist irrespective of whether it's the physical location or merely the access.
Thank you.
Professor Jones and Dr. MacKellar.
I think With regards to the right to refuse treatment, I don't agree that rights to refuse treatment are never suicidal. I think you might have a suicidal refusal of treatment. But we respect refusals of treatment for other reasons. We respect refusals of treatment because it's a kind of right of non-interference. And this is to do with our sort of limits of how we bump into each other and worry about coercion. So if we didn't have a right to refuse, we could be coerced to be treated by doctors. We can be coerced to be treated by doctors, but only in very specific circumstances and limited by law. And in general, we don't like to have coercion by doctors. That's why we have a refusal to treat. In relation to this being different to suicide in other circumstance, I think that might be because our archetype for suicide is youth suicide, because that's a kind of I'd say that it's not a sexy subject, but in as much as suicide gains publicity and people have campaigns about suicide, it's the youth suicide that pulls on the heartstrings. But if you look at rates of suicide, that it's actually older men, men over 65, men over 85, very much higher rates of suicide. But that's not what you see reported. You know, it's the two teenagers who die in the car. That's what people, you know, they care about. Many people I had a friend who committed suicide who was disabled, wouldn't fall under the terms of this bill because wasn't, well, may have fallen under the terms of this bill. But because he had a long-term chronic condition. He committed suicide in the same way of an old-fashioned or traditional type. People who are vulnerable do commit suicide. People who are older do commit suicide. This bill applies to people with chronic conditions. Applies to life-limited, progressive, chronic conditions who may have years to live. So it isn't just about people who are imminently dying. So I don't think you can separate so easily the difficulties, the depression, the difficulty of coping in these cases from the cases that, in many cases that we currently have of suicide. And related to that, I'd say, and this is go back to the data stuff, in England at the moment, there's a similar bill, and one of the arguments which has been put forward for that bill is that that bill is an answer to suicide among terminally ill people. That already people who are terminally ill are committing suicide in various ways. And if they had assisted dying, then this would be an alternative for the horrible deaths at the moment they have when they hoard up pills and then they take them. But the evidence, it's difficult to get out, but the evidence is that from those, when you legalise it, you don't reduce the number of suicides among this category of people. You still have high levels of suicide, and indeed Oregon has a much higher than average rate of suicide. Switzerland has a much higher rate than average of suicide. The highest rate of suicide in Western Europe is in Belgium. These are not exactly parallels because there are many, many factors that go into these, but I think that there are connections here. I don't think you can't altogether distinguish thinking about suicide and suicide prevention among vulnerable people, among those with disabilities and the elderly, from this kind of legislation. They're not so separable.
Dr. McKellar, and then Mr. Preston, and then we've got a last series of questions. And
just 2 points that Mr. Harvey made. The first one, to say that he is right, the concept of dignity does not appear in this legislation. But I used to work in the Council of Europe drafting human rights law in biomedicine. And there in Strasbourg, I learned that all good legislation is based on human rights. All good human rights is based on human ethics. And all good human ethics is based on the inherent concept of human dignity. So all legislation is, in fact, based on human dignity, even though it might not mention it. And then another thing you said, and I quite agree with you, and this is something that Professor Jones just mentioned, a person who is on dialysis, who's only got a few months left, is entitled to switch off the machines. They see it as a burden, and that's something that we all accept. But there's one issue that maybe hasn't been mentioned yet in this whole discussion, and that is the role of suicide facilitators. I mean, in the policy memorandum, it is mentioned that maybe, this is what I understand anyway, that the Humanist Society Scotland may take on some of these roles anyway, some of the roles of suicide facilitators. But I was just watching a film very recently of what was happening in Switzerland with the group Exit, the French section of Exit. Exit is only for Swiss people who live in Switzerland. And these are volunteers, and there was about a dozen volunteers participating in Exit as facilitators. And the film was heartrending to see the anguish eventually and the psychological tiredness that these facilitators were experiencing. It is not easy facilitating a suicide. And so far, the Humanist Society Scotland do a great job in doing weddings, secular weddings, and also funerals. But that is completely different from being a suicide facilitator. No, I don't think anybody in this room, maybe there is, but I don't believe anybody in this room would like to become a suicide facilitator. From a psychological perspective, what you're seeing is somebody dying again and again and again. And the amount of work that these Swiss suicide facilitators, and this is only for the French part, and there's 12 of them, they're overwhelmed and they're extremely tired. And at the end of the film, Dr. Jérôme Sobel, who's the president of the French version of Exit, says, "We're not doing really a task. What we're doing is basically a vocation. We've got to do this." And I'm concerned that people who might be in favor of assisted suicide may find themselves eventually becoming suicide facilitators just because they're in favor of assisted suicide. And I think that would be very dangerous for them because they do not know what they're getting into. To become a suicide facilitator, you have to be extremely psychologically robust, and that has to really be taken into account, I believe.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you. Can I just make one short comment on that as well, with connection with what Dennis Robertson was asking about coercion? Given that you've got a facilitator, you need to book a facilitator. When the facilitator comes, does that add an added coercion into it, in that you're using that person's time? And that's maybe something to reflect on. But I wanted to ask about conscience clauses. I know we just touched on this very briefly. But is there any way that we could put something that would allow people to opt out? Because in a way, it's not about personal autonomy. It's about the autonomy of the doctors and the like who are looking at the request for assisted suicide. Because at the end of the day, they have the final word on that. And if you can't put in a conscience clause into the legislation, you're asking people to actually maybe go against their own beliefs or indeed their training to facilitate that. So what you would find was different standards being carried out by different people, unless you can give people the option to either opt in or opt out of this. And is there any way in this legislation we could do that?
And I was going to make one point, but now I must make two, but I will be brief, I promise. The first one is the question of existing decisions to refuse treatment, to withdraw treatment, which Mr. Harvey has raised. When a doctor takes somebody off dialysis, with or without the patient's consent, when a doctor withdraws life-saving treatment with or without the patient's consent, it is not done in order to bring about the death of the patient. It is done in the expectation that the patient will probably die, but it's done because the treatment is unduly burdensome or it's futile. Intent is very important in ethics, and it's ethics we've been talking about this morning. Now, can I switch to the conscience clause? Because I think it's a very important point, because there has to be a conscience clause at some point. You can't force doctors to do this. But it has one very unfortunate side effect, that the majority, if assuming the situation north of the border is what it is south of the border, only one in five doctors say at the moment they would actually participate in processes like this. Now, the net result of that is that anyone who wants this is going to find himself or herself in the hands of a small number of referral doctors who know even less about them than the doctors with whom they are registered. We have to have a conscience clause, but it does have an unfortunate downside.
Anyone? Professor Jones, briefly, thanks.
I think we've just seen a decision at the Supreme Court in England overturning a decision in Scotland in respect to conscience clauses for abortion, and that came as a surprise to some people, not to others, in terms of what they had thought was the protection of a conscience clause. So if you do have a conscience clause, then there's also something to bear in mind about how what's ostensibly in the conscience clause may be subsequently interpreted by lawyers. So that's just again on the surface of the bill, and that will be influenced by human rights law and various things. So it seems extraordinary that there isn't a conscience clause, but also I would not overestimate the kind of protections which a conscience clause would give. Without thinking about a broader human rights... an issue at the moment in Belgium is that there is no duty to refer, for example. There is no duty to refer to another doctor for euthanasia. They were thinking of bringing it in, but they didn't. So at the moment, there isn't a duty to refer. But in respect to abortion in this country, there is a duty to refer. I think that for if a conscience clause, whatever the conscience clause had about a duty to refer, I think that the interpretation of the law in England will be influenced by the general views of conscientious objection, which is that you do have a duty to refer, I mean, as said in the opposite dicta of the Supreme Court judgment. And I think, therefore, which is just to say that whatever is in the clause needs to be, you need to have thought of how that will be interpreted. I think the problem I have with conscience clauses is they kind of assume that everybody has a duty to do this unless they opt out. I think that's the wrong way around. It isn't clear to me that anybody in this law, as it stands, it doesn't clear that there's any duty to provide this. I mean, there's a question, there's a sort of assumption that once this happens, the ministers will take it on and the bodies will take it on, and then it will become a right, and therefore there will be a duty to provide that right, there will be a duty to... But there's nothing in the law which says that. Now, if there's no duty to provide it, you don't need a conscience clause, because you just say, well, this is not something I have a duty to provide. But I think that what's unexamined here is the more it looks like medical care, the more it becomes something which you think you have a right to as part of end-of-life care. That means also that the regulators have a duty to regulate, the ministers have a duty to provide resources, nice guidance on poisons that you use for this stuff. You have to have that in place when it's part of, if it's part of ordinary medical care. And then you have to start opting out of it. So I think that a number of submissions on this bill pointed out that there's sort of assumptions about what would happen with other people. And I agree with what Professor Laurie said about that you need a whole framework, you need to think about a whole framework. And the likely framework is that this will be considered medical care, and therefore something which you have a right to, and therefore which something that other people have a duty to provide unless they opt out by a conscience clause. And also that your ability to do that by a conscience clause will be limited by what lawyers in general have said about conscience clauses. So
conscious
think about that.
Bob Doris opened up and was wanting back in as well, way back. So Bob, can you, cover some areas, and then I've got another two questions, and I need to make progress for the next 15 minutes.
I think it kind of links the conscience clause, because I think it's about the role of the medical professional within the process if this legislation was to be passed. One of the things I was looking at is what would be a life-limiting condition, and it's not defined within the bill. And for example, type 2 diabetes, in theory, reduces life expectancy by up to 10 years. So who would have a duty to inform people who are not coping with their type 2 diabetes that they have a treatment option, which is assisted suicide? And where would that sit within the relationship between a medical professional and their patient? And at what point would that be done? I mean, Scotland and the rest of the UK has a series of managed clinical networks by which patient pathways are quite clearly steered. And I'm just wondering whether this bill could lead to medicalisation of assisted suicide, whereas you go through these various managed clinical networks for a variety of conditions, whether it's via your GP or GP referral, the duty that's then placed on the medical professional to manage you through, with your choice along the way, of course, but to manage you through to one of those options being assisted suicide, and where that sits with the fundamental role of the medical professional to protect and enhance and nurture life and health and well-being. And that would be one of my issues with it. And I'm just seeking to tease out whether anyone else would perhaps share some of those anxieties, and if the bill can be improved. So I'm taking my personal views out of it. The bill can be improved to give reassurances in relation to some of this.
Thanks, Paul. Any responses? Briefly, please.
Look at what the GMC says in good medical practice in regard to treatment options. If you consider it a treatment option, then a doctor has a duty to inform the patient of their range of options. So if it's to be kept out of that, it's not just a matter of a conscience clause. You also have to think about how it relates to GMC guidance and how it relates to medical care generally. Because as soon as it goes into the medical care category, then a whole lot of other stuff will come into play, including a duty to suggest it, a duty to show that you have a right to it.
Anyone else? Professor Laurie.
To the guiding principle of this proposal, which is the individual's autonomy. I would hope that the individuals would be supported to take responsibility for the sorts of decisions that they might take at the end of their life. My understanding about the conscience clauses is it's a reserved matter for Westminster in terms of professional regulation. That's why they didn't want to try and get involved here. But then arguably, in terms of exploring a broader framework, you would then have sort of engagement with the professional regulatory bodies, such as the GMC and the BMA, the Doctors' Union, about what they would consider to be ethically appropriate support for the autonomy of their professionals in sort of steering this particular pathway. But I would bring it back to that responsibility for the individuals at the end of the day.
How would that change then if it was termed as a therapeutic?
Once you consider it as a treatment option. I mean, this is not like abortion. The only reason I brought it up in relation to abortion is because of conscience clause, and that's the most famous conscience clause. Once you consider it a part of medicine, presumably part of end-of-life care, then all of the ways in which that's regulated in terms of a doctor has a duty to inform people of the whole range of options. So it would become a duty of doctors to say one of your options is that you might want assisted dying if that's a legal option. Because as a medical profession, if it's a medical thing, then even if he conscientiously objects to doing it, he has a duty to inform people that they have a right to it. And so you also have a right, you also may have a duty to suggest it in certain circumstances if you thought it would be beneficial. You plug in, look, read the GMC guidance on good medical practice, and also in particular I would say the GMC guidance on treatment and care at the end of life. And imagine that assisted dying is a treatment option. And just put it through the regulation and see what the pattern would be. And I think that's a real possibility of this happening, because even though the facilitators might not be doctors, you've got three doctors involved with this thing. There's medical notes, there's the decisions about conditions. There's a lot of medicine here, and I think the default is that you'd see it regulated in the same way.
Yes, it's interesting, isn't it, that the bill actually is physician-assisted suicide so far as the decision-making process is concerned, but when it comes to the actual act, it ceases to be physician-assisted suicide. And in fact, it's very unclear what kind of assistance can be provided under the bill. I mean, are you allowed to push somebody under a train, for example? You know, it talks about drugs or other means. But it, south of the border, I keep using that phrase, I'm afraid, but south of the border, where Lord Falconer's bill is being considered at Westminster, the concept has been raised that these decisions should be taken by the High Court. Now, at the moment, as things stand with Lord Falconer's bill, they would be taken by the High Court after they've been taken by doctors, which is a little bit strange. It would just be a rubber stamping process. But one possibility might be to consider whether, as well as taking doctors out of the assistance process, take them out of the assessment process and leave doctors simply providing professional advice to somebody else making those decisions.
Nanette, you want in on this?
Vaguely touched on by Professor Jones earlier, but I mean, we're not really just talking doctors. I mean, we're talking, depending on the setting, this happening, nurses, pharmacists, and I mean, the pharmacist who was here last week felt very, very strongly that there should be a conscience clause written into legislation and not on the face of the bill, as far as pharmacy was concerned, because they I presume, I know there are other forms of suicide other than by drug, but I presume the vast majority would be have pharmacist involvement in the actual provision of the means for suicide.
Give Patrick Harvey and Graeme, just supplementary on this question, Patrick. No.
I mean, I reacted a little there to the comment about pushing people under trains. I'm sure the committee is capable of telling when someone's taking this subject seriously and when they're not. I think I would just refer to the comments that were discussed last week in relation to a conscience clause, a recognition that pretty much everybody who's discussed this issue acknowledges that a conscience clause is required, but the fact that the regulation of medical professionals is reserved. Witnesses last week seemed to be open to the argument that the conscience option is something that can be delivered through regulations, doesn't have to be in primary legislation. I would just ask for reactions to that. The robustness of it is clear, and I think just finally it's worth reflecting that the recent judgment on the conscience clause in relation to abortion clarified this situation as people have understood it for a long time, rather than overturning it as was suggested.
Any response to that? No. Okay, it may have been more appropriate for last week anyway. I think I've got Mike McKenzie. Are you okay, Mike? Thanks for that. Nanette, yes, quickly. Yeah.
Again, last week it was pointed out that there's a very fine line to be drawn between assistance and actual euthanasia, and there isn't a clear definition of what the facilitator's role actually is. Can any of the people around the table have comment on that?
First of all, I mean, the bill actually mentions in section 18 in the title, nature of assistance, no euthanasia. And that's something that I picked up. There is no definition of euthanasia, even though it's in the title of the bill. So I think that should maybe be clarified. Sometimes there is a very fine line. And this is why it would be very important, if this bill did come into effect, that the facilitator is present. I think there was some discussion last week or the week before that, whether or not even a facilitator must always be present. In Article 19, it says a licensed facilitator is to use best endeavours to be with the person. But what does this best endeavours mean? Normally in legislation, it would be a licensed facilitator shall be present. So there's a lot of questions there. Personally, I think it should be like done if it does take place. Go down the same road as Switzerland, where the facilitator brings the drug, provides the drug to the patient, the person, who then takes the drug themselves, and then makes sure that there's no drug left at all. And then the facilitator goes away again, making sure that nobody else has put the cup to the patient. Because if the cup is put into the mouth of the drugs is put into the mouth of the patient, that becomes euthanasia. Yeah. It's also interesting that where euthanasia and assisted suicide are both legalized, like in the Netherlands, it's usually euthanasia that is, I think, 20 times more present than assisted suicide. With assisted suicide, things can go wrong. The person can take a long time to die. The person can even wake up after death. And then there's a whole lot of complications. And that is why euthanasia is used in the Netherlands 20 times as often, because then you can really make sure that the person is dead. But for the facilitator to go away when this is taking place and just let the relatives be with the... I think that would be unacceptable. Who knows what the relatives will do? I mean, the relatives might not even be aware of the legislation. So that would have to be tightened up, I believe.
But Professor Laurie.
As this discussion has demonstrated, there's incredibly fine ethical judgments that will have to be taken at all points in any framework that's laid out, and we can't expect any single piece of legislation to address all the different points. What I would suggest is that if there were an authority we put in place that not only had a supervisory role, but also an advisory role, so when you were talking about somebody's final arrangements, you could actually come with, you know, suggestions about this is what we're proposing, and then seek some guidance about what was appropriate. But what the bill does make very clear is the final act has to be that of the individual. So it would be about the fine nuances about what counts as the final act.
Can I just, you know, put this to you, just to get clarification for some earlier offences, that, you know, that leading up to that final act and the procedures that would be put in place, you suggested there would be an offence for that, for breaches. And earlier, did you suggest that you could create an offence for those people who were not following those procedures properly? Or
the point I made much earlier was actually that I think if we're talking about sort of manifest cases of undue influence, where that, yes, that has been established, I would like to see an offence of that, where somebody has clearly unduly influenced somebody in these circumstances.
Would that be a specific criminal offence?
Arguably, that could be a specific criminal offence, yes.
What would that look like, or have you thought that through? Just
Again, I'm not a criminal lawyer, so I couldn't necessarily say what type of offence it would be, but that could be for discussion and exploration. Because what the bill does do is actually take account of acts or errors or omissions that are made in good faith. So it does recognise that will not necessarily lead to criminal liability or civil liability. The corollary is, if somebody's actually deliberately coerced somebody into circumstances, we should make it manifestly clear that that would be subject to criminal prosecution.
Professor Jones.
Could I just very clearly, I'm not in favour of this bill, but that doesn't mean to say I think all criticisms of the bill are justified, and I think that it is fairly clear that it intends to be an assisted suicide bill and not a euthanasia bill. There will be fine distinctions, and some of that will have to be in regulation. In terms of there being such a distinction. My concern in relation to euthanasia is not that the bill would legalise it. I don't think this bill would legalise it, but I think that there would be further down the line, if this were accepted, then I think that a number of people would want to revisit it, and then through various other changes, then people will say, well, if this, then logically, why not also euthanasia? But I think that this is not a euthanasia bill. It is an assisted suicide bill. It is therefore, in that respect, different from the Low Countries and like Switzerland and the states in the United States that have assisted dying legislation. And the final act is your own act. And I also would commend, as I did, I would commend Scotland in calling it an assisted suicide bill, not an assisted dying bill, which I think is seriously misleading a language which many people, probably if you polled the majority of people, would think applied to euthanasia as well as assisted suicide. But this is not a euthanasia law, it's an assisted suicide law.
Mr. Preston.
I just echo what Dr. Jones has said. I mean, there is refreshing candour in this bill, and having come from looking at the bill in Westminster, I think it's very refreshing. There is something of a disconnect on this question of licensed facilitators, which I've never really understood. What is not clear to me, when we get to Section 17, it's quite clear that we've come to the end of the decision-making process. But what is not clear is how drugs or other substances get to the licensed facilitator and then to the person concerned. We go, first of all, we have Section 18, which seems to be saying there must be no euthanasia. I mean, I'm a little puzzled by subsection 1, which says nothing in this act authorizes anyone to do anything that itself causes another person's death. Well, I would have thought supplying somebody with lethal drugs to take could be construed as that, but never mind, we'll leave that on one side. If you look at Section 19, the licensed facilitator's role is to provide, before, during, and after the act of suicide, such practical assistance, then comfort and reassurance, and then to be with the person when any drug or other substance or means dispensed or otherwise supplied for the suicide is taken or used. I'm not quite clear what is the machinery for moving from the decision to supplying the substance. It doesn't seem to be prescribed anywhere in the bill.
Like the same, you know, I'm going to call it to an end at this point. I think we've had a good long session. We appreciate your attendance here, your participation, and the views that we've heard this morning. I think have been interesting and in some ways challenging to the committee. We appreciate all the time and the valuable time that you've given us, and I'm going to draw this session to a close at this point. Thank you all very much for being here.